My name is Rick Morris, and I'm a recovering alcoholic and addict. I've been clean and sober since August the 3rd of 1992. I am the child of a woman that came to the North when a lot of African-American people came to the North during a period called the Great Migration. And my mother did domestic work. She had three children. My oldest brother passed away before I was born, and then I had a sister ahead of me who had Down syndrome, and then myself, so I was the baby. My father and I, our relationship was like the Cat Stevens song, Cats in the Cradle. You know, when I was young, I really, really wanted him to be my dad. You know, he was drinking and doing his thing, so he didn't have time. He got sober, praise God, and then he wanted me to be his son, but I had a lot of anger, love-hate relationship with them, so I didn't want to be a son, but we were able to rekindle that through the rooms of recovery. Growing up, I never felt good about myself. You know, I grew up in a time when people talked about you, you know, kids can be bullies. But then something came along and I started to realize something, that I was good athletically. And people started giving me a name. They started calling me Big Rick. You know, I had arrived. I was, you know, a well-known guy in the grade school that I went to. So I started learning that the more angry I was, the more violent I was, the more people I beat up, the more they respected me and revered me. So that would follow me for a long time in my life. But something happened. My mother got a job, and we're talking about the late 60s, early 70s. And we moved from a 99.9% African-American area to an area that was 70% Caucasian. To be frank with you, I'd never seen so many white people in my life. I was very uncomfortable. My mother did something for me. She enrolled me in football at the junior high school, and I went out and did what it is I do. And, you know, I was a linebacker, and, you know, so I was already sacrificing my body just to have a big name, you know, in a small, try to be a big fish in a small pond, so to speak. My mother was stricken with breast cancer. She was a good businesswoman, so we could keep our house. We didn't lose our house. She had mortgage insurance and car insurance, and she had all the insurances, but she didn't have the money for the life things. And that's when I began to start some new habits. I began to sell drugs. In fact, they had just built a new mall near our school. And, you know, I always tell people jokingly that I had a store in the mall, and I began selling joints and nickel bags. But the entire time, you know, I was always a chameleon. I put on the look that people wanted to see from me. I was a good athlete. I had great grades. I was good socially. I also sold the most dope. You know, so I lived a different kind of way. And I used to sit down in the woods. I met another guy. He was a white guy, same age I was, 13, a little bigger than me. And we started drinking. That's where it pretty much started at. We would go down into the woods that were near our house, and he and I would sit down there and we'd talk. I'd tell him, you know, when I'm having kids, I'm gonna be a better father to my kids than my dad ever was to me. And my biggest goal was to go to Ohio State and play football for Whitty Hayes and to take care of my mom and my sister with Down syndrome. That's really all I wanted to do. The time came for me to choose a school. My mother had done domestic work for a guy who was a longtime U.S. congressman, and his name was Thomas Ludlow Ashley. He had worked it out that I got an appointment to West Point. If I had done that, then my life pretty much would have been set. But I started making decisions based on my addiction and my alcoholism at a very young age. I was recruited by a university south of here. They flew me in. I'd never flown in a plane in my entire life. I stayed in a hotel, never stayed in a hotel in my entire life. They had company come to my room, if you can read in between the lines. And they gave me all the alcohol that I could drink. Where do you think I went? I'm an alcoholic. I went to University of Kentucky. That's where I went. Well, there I had no parental support. I couldn't buy a pizza. I couldn't get a pair of jeans. I couldn't take a girl out on a date. So since I didn't know anything better, I started doing what I had always done. I started selling dope in the dorms, you know, and my mother was getting sicker and sicker, and I was missing her, and I wasn't there for her, so I started drinking more. I started going to class less, and I got in trouble at the University of Kentucky. It wasn't the University of Kentucky's fault, it was purely mine. I came back to Toledo, Ohio. I got married to my first wife. We were both 18. We started having children. I got a job in a huge factory, easy, cushy job. I did what I always do. You know, I always did at that time. I drove a forklift. I found out that driving a forklift and selling weed in a factory was a good come up, and that's what I started doing. And long sharking money. You know, I have to say that my mother had raised me in a certain kind of way. And the more dirt, the more scurvy and scandalous things I did, you know, the worse I felt as a person on the inside. You know, my alcohol consumption and my drug addiction was getting worse and worse. Also, the quantity of what I was selling was getting larger and larger. My life looked well on the outside. At the age of 24, I had a brand new house, driving a Cadillac, probably one of the prettiest Cadillacs that our city had ever seen. Was living life large. I was a terrible husband, terrible dad. I have always bought real estate. I always had my wife and my family in one location, you know, my side chick and another chick in another location. Things began to begin a cycle. Almost every year, I went to jail late summer, early fall. You know, I'd start in the winter and I would be good for a while, and, you know, I would be a good husband, a good dad, and then something would trigger me, some disappointment or something good could trigger me. And then by fall, I would go to jail. And May the 1st of 1992, I tried to kill two people. I fell in love with one of the side chicks and left my family. One day she took off with my money and my dope, and I found her. The crime I committed was just over the border in the state of Michigan. Before I could get back to Ohio, the Monroe County Sheriff's apprehended me. They couldn't take me to jail. My injuries were so bad, they had to bring me by ambulance down to Toledo to St. Vincent's Hospital so I could be treated. And this is when God began to intervene in my life. And I had a real attitude about God. And because I grew up hearing that pray and believe and it'll happen. Well, I prayed and believed and it didn't happen. And it happened repeatedly like that. I couldn't walk. They didn't know if I would ever walk again. If you see me now, that's why I walk with a limp. I wish I could say I changed right then, but I didn't. I left the hospital and I went on the run. August of 1992, the same year, a situation occurred where someone disrespected me. And so I thought the only recourse was to shoot him. And I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I set the dope down on the table, set my gun down. I called my ex-wife, the mother of my first four kids. I was gonna commit suicide because I was just so miserable, so lost. I was wanted. I just didn't wanna live. You know, she didn't approach me, why don't you go get sober? Why don't you do this? She approached me, what about the promise you made about your children? What about your children? And thinking about my kids growing up fatherless like I did. You know, without a provider, without a caretaker, without someone to share wisdom. You know, that's the most important gift we have is wisdom. From that day, Monday, August the 3rd of 1992, till today, I'm not taking a drink and I haven't used any drugs. There, I began to find out that the real issue wasn't the drinking and the drugs. The real issue was my mind. I began to work on my recovery. I didn't leave the facility, went from there to a men's halfway house. I was clean and sober a year. I went and turned myself in. One of the most scariest things I ever did. At the same time, there was a young lady that was writing her doctoral thesis from the University of Michigan on why the urban black male was so violent. And I volunteered to be one of the test subjects. Really, that was one of the best things that ever happened to me in my life. I started seeing her and we began to work on some things. I finally found the space to talk about being molested from the age of 5 to about the age of 8. And I never looked at it. So therefore, I had sexual issues. I would do things, you know, here I had a good wife and you know, I was never satisfied and I would do stuff. In our literature, in the 4-step, it talks about those things, you know, our instincts and how they dominate us, how they drive us. You know, they drive us so bad, it's like getting a cart before the horse and identifying those things. You know, I have a fear of being alone because my mother died and because I always gave my love to the wrong people, like self-fulfilling prophecies, everybody always leaves. I would be in relationships. I'd be 1 foot committed to somebody and another foot getting the next number and getting the next date, you know, and wondering why I didn't feel good. So I drank to feel good. I drank to be all right with me. I hung out with people who were doing the same scandalous and scurvy stuff that I was doing. So, you know, birds of a feather flock together. And it wasn't until I got into recovery, began to work the steps, began to look at me, began to take my own inventory, began to look at my own character defects, and I got a sponsor who was open and honest with me, didn't criticize me, didn't condemn me, but helped me to walk through the steps, that I found something amazing. I found joy. I found peace. And that's where I am in my life now. Who would have thought it? The addict, alcoholic, recovering criminal. I'm recovering from a lot of things. That's why they call it recovery, because I'm recovering. May you find recovery too.